Good morning, and hope you guys are great today. It's another good day to be living and good opportunity day. So let's look at it that way. Good opportunity. It's August 19th, and we are in 3 John, part 3, right there. Talk about imitation. So John is writing. He's the head over the missions work in Western Turkey. And there is a problem. And the problem in this book in particular is that you got a guy who's running one of the churches that is pretty not a good guy, kind of a mean guy. And anything that the Bible says in the New Testament for a leadership in the church, this person's doing the opposite. And this guy is named, his name was Diotrephes, and it says he loves to be first. And remember, a lot of churches were in the homes back then. And that's why in books like Titus, which is just a little behind 3 John there, you'll read about people that subvert whole households. And that idea of going into a home and taking authority of that home, and it's now occupying that territory, you know, the pastor, and he's aggressive. And I don't know about you guys, but those are dudes that I never wanted to imitate growing up at all, man, not in the slightest. Scared to death of those hardcore preacher types that would just come at you, and not something I wanted to imitate at all. So Diotrephes is this guy who wants to be first. He wants to subvert whole households. John says he's going to call attention when he gets there to what this guy's doing. And he says that this guy is also going around gossiping. And another thing you don't want to imitate is gossiping. You got to kill the noise. You got to shut off the things that are prophetic voices in your mind today. And what I mean by prophetic voices is just voices that move you, voices that turn you to, it can be fear, it can be discontentment, it can be anger, you know, envy, these kind of things, the things that go on in here. Those voices that hit you, whatever you're listening to, whatever you got on, you can call it news, you can call it whatever you want, but if it's that prophetic voice that's moving you, that's turning you, or let me say it this way, if it's a voice that's turning you, it's a prophetic voice. It's, and now it might be a false prophetic voice, but it's something that is saying things maybe maliciously, maybe gossiping about things that aren't true, and we just don't know, right? And so we have to be careful about those things. That's why even, you know, it's good to test the Bible. Find out if it's true. Do your homework. These are things that are super important, right? Well, this guy, man, he just was a gossiper, and he was just a malicious guy. And he spoke bad about the Apostle John and about those other ministers. And he also stops those who want to do so and puts them out of the church. This guy also kicked people out of the church where it met, probably in someone's home, but he kicked them right out of it. He said, hey, you know what? If you're part of John's thing, forget it. We don't want you here, you know? And man, so don't want to imitate that guy, right? That's not a guy who builds bridges. It's not a guy who cares, not a guy who has a lot of compassion, nothing like that. A guy who's out for his own gain, obviously. And so sometimes people can usurp a whole lot of power and authority over people. And that's why the Bible tells actually pastors to be an example to the flock, serving them as overseers, but be an example to the flock. You know, be an example in all things to the flock. And so, you know, we don't want to lord over the New Testament says. We don't want to subvert. We don't want to occupy, like, you know, you're mine and I'm taking over this and that kind of idea. No, the Lord's the head of the church, and that's what the Bible teaches. God, His son is the head of the church. We are all stewards of his world, of his body, his church too. So it says, dear friends, do not imitate what is evil. That's why I titled part three, imitate, right? Don't imitate what is evil, but do what is good. Anyone who does what is good is from God. Anyone who does what is evil is not seeing God. So he says anyone who does it is evil, and he's referring to these teachers, obviously, this guy Diotrephes in particular. But he's talking about that he's blinded. He's not seeing correctly. Anybody who's doing evil is not seeing things correct. And that's true. I mean, if you're even a Christian out there, when you fall into sin, right, you're just not seeing things correctly a lot of times, right? You see things wrongly. You buy into something. You cave in to temptation. Jesus never caved in. Could you imagine that? Never caving into temptation. And that was Jesus. Jesus always did the right. He was always good. And he's always one that we should be imitating in every way. Do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. Now, the Bible teaches something really interesting. And that is, when Jesus was asked or told, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus responded in a really neat way. He said, why do you call me good? There's only one that is good, and that is God. What an interesting statement Jesus says. There's only one that is good, and that is God. So if you want to imitate the ultimate good, that means you're imitating God. He is the ultimate good, and he is the total objective good. And that's why I say that there's no greater person to imitate than Jesus. And John tells us that, not to imitate things that are evil, but what is good. And what is good? Well, God is good. And imitation is really interesting, because there's a lot of things, obviously, we learn by imitation, you know, speech. I don't remember ever taking an English course when I was growing up as a little guy, and, you know, before kindergarten, learning English or the ABCs or anything. It was imitation. You know, my parents said things, you know, say dad, say mom. And I went mom and dad. And, you know, we learn by imitation, and which is so true. And when I was, you know, it's like when you learn by imitation, you have to study someone's life and study what they're doing, what they're saying, how their mouth moves. I was talking to some French Canadians, because I have a lot of French Canadian blood in me. So I was down at the hockey rink talking to French Canadians, and I hear them say quoi de neuf, or they hear them say words, you know. And I try to pronounce it and try to mimic the mouth, the way the mouth looks when they're saying it. And there's some things they say that my mouth can't seem to imitate properly. But that's when we're imitating, we're looking at something really intensely. And if you could remember what it was like to imitate, like if you were in sports, or, you know, you wanted to learn a hobby or something. For me, surfing. Guitar, those kind of things. To imitate meant to watch intensely, to look at something intensely, to follow someone is the same idea as to imitate. It's to look at intently. And Paul always reiterated this, by the way. He said, follow me, you know, in his writings. Follow me, you know, imitate me. You'll follow what I'm doing. Hey, hang out with me. And Jesus told us to do that, to no servant is greater than his master, to imitate him, to look at him, watch him, observe, right? And this is what we want to do, like what I did with surfing and guitar. And with guitar, it was kind of interesting because it's like I would look at how their hands moved. So like if I picked up a guitar, let me pick up a guitar for you guys. You guys don't mind, right, if I do this? No? Okay. You guys ain't going to hear it, but I'll just show you kind of how it works. Like when I picked up a guitar, if it didn't look right, if it looked like it was all jacked, right, I would look in the mirror and I would look at a picture of someone playing guitar and I would go, well, what? How do they look? And then I would imitate how they looked, how their fingers looked. Did it look right when I was playing? Or did it look, was my hands looking right on the neck, you know? Or was my hands all messed up? Was my shoulder like this? You know, were my shoulders really high like that? Or were they relaxed? Was my posture up like this? You know, were my fingers hitting the right parts of the frets? You know? And now this is a Bible study. This isn't a guitar lesson. But you get the idea of what I'm telling you is that imitation is something that we're meticulous about. When you're imitating someone, you're really looking intensely at them. And so he says, dear friends, do not imitate what is evil. Do not fixate on what is evil. And man, is that always a temptation for us, right? To fixate on the things that are bent. When you think of the word evil, what do you think of? A lot of people think of wickedness or things like that, but I tend to think of iniquity. I tend to think of evil as like a bending. It's like a bend, a distortion. Evil is the distortion of good, right? It's like there's something that's good. When we're saying something's good, that means it's a comparative. That means we can look at something and go, well, if that's the good, there must be something that is the bad or something that's the evil, the bending of the good, taking something good and going too far with it. Fear is good. It's good that you have fear in you, right? If you didn't have fear, you'd get hit by a train if you were on the train track, right? And the train's coming. But when you have fear, there's a good fear, right? To go, man, the train's coming, I'm getting off. But if that fear gets out of control, right, where fear is now running everything in your life, then it becomes bent. Then it becomes bending. It's no longer being useful for that which is good, but it now is being used for your detriment, for your unhealth, you know, and for it's not good for your physical health, and it's not good for your spiritual health. And that's how it is with everything. Sex is awesome. Sex is good. But when we use sex, we can use it, we can bend it so that we now, it's no longer for our health or for society's health or for future generations' health, those kind of things. We're no longer looking at it in that scope. And so we take what is good and we bend. Nothing's wrong with alcohol, but you take alcohol, you can bend it, right? It no longer is for your good or for your health or anything like that. But you can take insecure, you know, you can take all kinds of things, topics, and move it in those directions. We want to fixate on what is good. And the perfect good is Jesus. So if you want to get meticulous about your life, and everybody is imitating someone. Everybody is looking at someone. I don't know who they're looking at. Some people are walking aimlessly on the planet, just imitating one another. Jesus called it the blind leading the blind. Will not both fall into a ditch, right? And many people do that. They just mimic people all over the place. They're just looking at other things. And we all do that as human beings, by the way. We all tend to look at one another. And when everybody's freaking out, we freak out with them. And right, toilet paper, right? We all remember that already. Yeah. Okay. So you can see how we kind of tend to imitate people, and it's kind of our nature. Again, fear gets bent and we move in that direction. We go in an unhealthy way. A way that's, it can become very irrational. So look to Jesus, right? And a dear friend, do not imitate what is evil, Diotrephes, right? He's all about himself, but what is good. Anyone who does what is good is from God, because God is the ultimate good, right? And so, and he's talking specifically about those ministers. Those ministers that are doing good, they're the ones that are from the Lord. They're the ones from God. Anyone who does what is evil in these in the ministry, these pastors, has not seen God. You know, so if they just are doing what Diotrephes is doing, where they're, you know, look at that list in verse 9 to verse 10. And then he mentions a really cool guy. He says, Demetrius is well spoken of by everyone. Isn't that cool? So what a great contrast to Diotrephes. Demetrius is well spoken of by everyone, and even by the truth itself. Meaning he's, this guy, the witnesses for this guy is everyone. Everyone loves this dude. He's just awesome. Compassionate, caring. He's not going to be quick to judge you. Just a beautiful dude, loves the Lord, wants to share the word with you guys. That's this dude. And even the truth itself speaks about him. It's a witness to him. We also speak well of him. We also speak well of him. John's using this kind of, you know, witness, like the idea of two or three witnesses here. You kind of get that idea. And it says, and you know that our testimony is true. What a great guy that we want to imitate is a guy like Demetrius, right? Well spoken of by everyone. And now he doesn't mean probably everyone. I'm sure maybe Diotrephes didn't like Demetrius too well. But what John's saying is within the healthy group, the people that are walking in love, you know, they really speak highly of this guy. Why? Because he's a loving guy. He's walking in the truth. And what does John always say about walking in the truth? Walking in the truth is walking in knowing who Christ is and having good doctrine on who Christ is, and it's showing itself in you in love, in you becoming truth, you becoming like Christ, and those kind of things happening. And this work of sanctification, which is humility, is a part of that. Repentance is all a part of that. Dealing with our sins is all a part of it. We all have those things, but we're all dealing with it, working on those things, right? We all speak well of him. And he says, I have much to write to you. I do not want to do so with pen and ink. So he doesn't want to get out the pen anymore and write. He wants to see him. It says face to face. He wants to have the mano to mano talk. And how cool is that, right? There's nothing like just seeing someone face to face and sitting down with them and having a chat. And John would love that. And hopefully we do too. You see, a minister is someone who loves to have that face to face time to be able to chat and talk. They don't just want that distant relationship, but they want that close koinonia fellowship, that close coming together, that is so important for John. Knows it's important for him, and it's important for those that he ministers to. So peace to you. Shalom. The friends here send their greetings. Greet the friends there by name. Isn't that great? They greet them by name. What does that mean? Personal, intimate. So really beautiful personal letter. A lot of great stuff in there. And remember, our little theme of the day was imitation. So you guys have a great one today. Good Wednesday. And we will be at Calvary Christian Fellowship teaching tonight on the book of Titus. If you're interested in understanding the book of Titus a little bit, come on out. Or watch us at CalvaryChristianFellowship.com with Senior Pastor Scott Richards. So we'll talk at you guys later. Have a great day, okay? Bye-bye.